So let my life be the proof of your love. Let my love look like you and what you made. It is good to be back. Eventually, we're going to get to Matthew chapter 16. And I say eventually because this morning is going to be a kind of extended introduction. And first, before I even get to the introduction of the message, I want to express appreciation for this congregation. And it's interesting that, Nate, a lot of the songs were about love, God's love. And it is so wonderful. God's love many times is experienced not directly from God. It's experienced through people that love us. And this congregation loves my wife and me. And it is very, very evident. And we experience it. And this past, months has been wonderful that you as a congregation have given to us, to me, to be able to refuel, to pray, to read, to write. And it's because of your love for me. And I don't deserve it. But it's God's love through you to me, to us. And I'm just greatly, greatly thankful and appreciative. And all those that filled in, like Nate said, the preaching and the coordination and Wednesdays and oh my goodness. And there's a few hiccups that we had to go through and we were here. For those of you that are watching on Facebook, or you're missing out if you don't attend Living Word, because this congregation is full of love. It really is. And it's the love of God poured in our hearts through the Holy Spirit, right? So I'm very, very grateful, and I look forward to see what the Lord's going to do in the next few years as we continue to communicate the Word of God. Not that we want to be popular, that's not the point, but we want to communicate the Word of God. Now, in contrast, and this is where I can get into my introduction to my message this morning, and I want to, as I said, it's going to be a series on our times, discerning the times that we live in. One of the greatest enemies that we have are enemies that we do not see or sense. They are invisible, but they can come into our minds, in our hearts, and we don't even know it. Those are powerful, powerful enemies, because they don't need a whole bunch of power to destroy us. Because before we know it, boom, there they are. And it can be in our thinking, in our emotions, in our decisions. And we just make decisions without knowing that the enemy has shaped us. Our enemy has directed us. As opposed to the Word of God directing and showing us. You see? So I want to spend, by this introduction, the fact is this, that the world has a discipleship program. The world has a discipleship program discipling you and me, attempting to disciple you and me. And they can be very, very effective. And so I want to look at that a little bit. Even this morning, listen, this morning, I want to read to you something that I was reading. China has a new social credit system, not financial credit, social credit system. Let me read to you the description. Starts off with something that you can imagine. Imagine calling a friend. Only instead of hearing a ringtone, you have a police siren and then a voice intoning, "Be careful in your dealing with this person." Would that put a damper on your relationship? It's supposed to warn you about this person. China has this system.
Listen to this. Welcome to China's social credit system, where a low score socially can ruin your life in more ways than one. Say you arrive at a Beijing airport intending to catch a flight to Canton, 1,200 miles south. The clerk at the ticket counter turns you away because, you guessed it, your social credit score is too low. Not only are you publicly humiliated in the ticket line, you are then forced to travel by slow train. What should have been a 3-hour flight becomes a 30-hour stop and go nightmare. All because the government, has declared you untrustworthy. Perhaps you defaulted on a loan, made a mistake of criticizing some government policy online, or just spent too much time playing video games on the internet. All of these actions and many more can cause your score to plummet, forcing citizens onto the most dreaded rung of China's deadbeat caste system. They call it Lao Lai. They call it Lao Lai. You know what it sounds like? Low life. You're put in this list of low life, low lie. And the punishments are shocking. The government's algorithms will go as far as to install an embarrassing ringtone on your phone of Lao Lai, shaming them every time they get a public call. The government is doing this. But an embarrassing ring, flight bans, and slow trains are just the beginning of the dystopian nightmare that is now daily life in China for tens of millions of people. A low social credit score will exclude you from well-paid jobs, make it impossible for you to get a house or a car loan, or even book a hotel room. The government will slow down post your profile on public blacklist for all to see. Now, this is in Australia. According to Australian ABC News, the government has produced a deadbeat map via an app on WeChat, which shows a radar-style graphic identifying every lowlife in the vicinity of the user. In other words, you have your phone. Man, there's a lot of lowlifes around me. I better get out of here. I mean, isn't that amazing? The government is able to do this. And listen, the world has a system going, a program to disciple people, and we're not even aware of it. For over 20 years or more now, there's these industries. They are called global culture industries. And these global culture industries are doing things to disciple people. So we are being shaped by our culture, our media, and not by the church or God's word. Shaped into customers and not Christ-like people. We are being shaped into, hey, buy stuff. Instead of into Christ-likeness. And we don't even know it. But they're doing it. They're very intentional. They have the studies. And let me say more about that because it's real, brothers and sisters. And that's why many Christians are very anemic. Very weak. Because we're being taken over by buying stuff and we're being discipled. That's why going to church, what? Oh, I have to. Oh, my goodness. But go to a concert? Man. How many people can I go with me? It used to be, man, going to church, man, who can I invite? Now, oh, that new restaurant opened up over there, man, there's no parking space. It's all gone. Why? Because we are being discipled by these global cultural industries. These companies study people. They study you and me. Every time you click on anything, it goes to a bunch of different people. They're telling, hey, this guy likes this, this doesn't like this, he hates this, he loves this, he buys this, he looks at this. Many companies. And then the more you click, the more you watch, the more information they have on you and me. And they're doing it. They surveil, they observe, they are attempting to change your values, life perspective, ideology. In other words, all your ideas, they're trying to change the way you think. They want you to look at objects in different ways. They're not just objects. They are things that give you life. Now you understand why, like in commercials, you know, pasta is talking to you. I mean, you know, this inanimate foods are talking to you. I mean, you think that's dumb, but they're part of discipling you and me. What has meaning in life? What has meaning in life? They are telling you what has meaning in life. It is no longer the word of God that's telling you what's the meaning of life. It's just mind-boggling. Let me just go through some things that to show you. One of the things that these cultural, global cultural industries do, they seek to change what's called a primary reference group. This group points to us in what is good and meaningful. It used to be, for instance, it used to be that people would turn to priests. They would turn to community elders. They would turn to wise individuals, right? It's no longer like that. I mean, I've known this for a long time, decades. When I get introduced into somebody, I don't want them to know that I'm a pastor. Because the moment they know that I'm a pastor, gone, man. They don't trust anybody, especially religious leaders. When it used to be where people would turn to their priest, their pastor is like, life. Oh, no, no. Community elders. This man, this woman has been here for decades and decades, and they have made wise decisions. Let's go talk to them. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me these days? Now, who are these individuals? How about people in the NBA, NFL? How about athletic superstars, bliss promise makers, and bliss promise makers, those that want to give you everything free, and they promise you God's blessings all the time, all the time, all the time, no problems. They can be preachers or they can be politicians, but they promise you the world. Oh, let's listen to them. It could have been somebody that were working at a bar yesterday, and today they're telling me what to do, what's most meaningful and how life works. Really? But that's what people are turning to. You see? Promise makers that have no substance at all because they do not know the word of God. But that's who people are now turning to. You know? People that can have the gift of gab, or they can do graphics, right? Media. Man, they know exactly. Man, if you wear these clothes, this is what's going to be communicated. If you wear your hair this way, that you're going to communicate this. If you say these words, I mean, they have this, are absolutely geniuses at communicating. And if you have the gift of gab and you have a professional behind you, man, you can make millions. You can influence thousands and thousands of people. You know, if you have just the right communications, oh my goodness, it is no longer the word of God. And these industries are very, very intentional at discipling people to no longer have the primary reference groups where people can go and get reference for life. You know, no, they're changing that. Symbols. They're changing the symbols. And symbols are powerful. They're very powerful. Just look at what happened a couple years ago with the issue of the flag, right? When we're supposed to be standing and putting our hands over our hearts. And some says, no, I'm not going to do that. Ooh, what an uproar, right? Why? Because the flag stands for something that's powerful, deep within the American soul, right? Symbols are powerful, but these global cultural industries are changing the symbols. For Christians, it used to be the cross. Oh my goodness, a powerful symbol. Church steeples. You know, I remember growing up. I grew up a Roman Catholic. And man, I'm telling you, you drove in front of the church and you kneeled down and you did this and you went on. There was a respect. Now, oh my goodness, are you kidding me? You go by a mall and it's 10 times more attractive than any church. Right? And we don't even know it. But these industries are discipling us. The Bible. I mean, just the Bible by itself. What? The president puts his hand on top of it to swear that he's going to do his job right. Now, well, it's just man-made. It's just stories. No, son. It is the word of God. But it's no longer that way. Right? Now, what is it? If you saw the symbol of Rolex, would you identify it? Right away. Rolex, you have arrived. You're now rich. No, you're not. You're in debt to your hood. Oh, but you got a Rolex. But that symbol, you see? That symbol. Nike. Anybody recognize the symbol of Nike? Oh, worldwide. Worldwide fame. Why? Because that symbol. You see, man, you are awesome. You're part of the awesome team. You see, you have meaning and you have power. You can do it. Just do it. You see, a simple check. How about an apple with a bite on it? The iPhone. Ooh, man, you are cool. You are in. You have the knowledge. You are hip. You are whatever. Just by that symbol. You have meaning in life. But you see, we don't think about it like that. We are being discipled. And we don't even know it. Here's another way that these global cultural industries are discipling us. They keep us so busy. They keep us so busy. Right? Whether it's buying or traveling or whatever. We no longer have time to spend hours talking to God. and talking to fellow believers about life. Oh my goodness, no! I'm 30 seconds late, man. Shut up. I gotta go to my next meeting. Oh, look. Oh, they are in the Bahamas. My goodness, where am I going? When am I going to? Oh, I'm so poor. Oh. These global industries are jamming and jamming and jamming business and stuff into us. Oh, but that's where life is. That's where life is at. So they tell us, and their lies from hell is not the word of God. Yesterday, this morning I told you about China, right? Yesterday, on the mail, I've never ordered, I don't know what, no, ESPN in my mailbox. A beautiful lady, totally, completely airbrushed, perfect eyes, perfect eyelashes, perfect color, perfect everything. Look out, world. Julie is coming to kick your front page. All right. Flip open. The first page, man. Look at that. Woo-hoo, I'd like to have one of those. And look at what it says. The road has a stunning new ally. Ally? Like, the road and this car have connected. And now they've connected and they're going to fulfill my life with meaning and love and pleasure and whoop, everything. The road has a new ally. Introducing the all-new Blazer. It's available with a twin-clutch advanced AWD system. What is that? You know, we look at the Bible, it's like, God, you just like, why do you have to say so complicated things, man? But we're buying it from ESPN. We're buying it from Chevrolet. He goes on. A choice of driver-inspired engines. Oh, my goodness. Now you can inspire the engine. I want to go to Hollywood. Boom, you know. I want to go. Boom. You inspire the engine. Wow. Talk about having an impact and power, man. And I mean, this is ridiculous. The more I read, the more. But we buy it. Look, it says, and an ingenious new cargo management system that features a sliding fence on rails of plastic to help keep your stuff secure and organized. Gotta buy plastic. The beautiful all-new Blazer. It's a SUV redesigned and reimagined. That was the first page on ESPN. I mean, it just goes on and on, brothers and sisters, and we're not even aware. Look at this one, man. God. A teenager on a skateboard. And there's a lady, 59 years old, sitting there with a skateboard, and she says, I can do this. You know what it says on the side? This is terrible, man. Age is but a number. I'll bet a really high number. For these seniors, athletes, going one-on-one with Father Time. wow, I can beat time. I am God. Of course, they're not saying that. But these global culture industries are discipling you and me. The next page just gets ridiculous. It looks terrible. These old people trying to do Olympic stuff. It's like, I'm telling you. That's just awful. It's funny, but it's, oh, the last page. The last page. You know what it says? Live like you're putting the world on notice. Live victoriously. Grey Goose vodka. And brothers and sisters, you and I are buying it. How do I know? When was the last time you spent the whole Sabbath day worshiping the one who died for you? I haven't. I'm just as bad as everybody else because I buy this garbage. The world is discipling you and me. The world is discipling you and me. Discipling so that we can become consumers by and by and by. It's not discipling us to become more like Jesus Christ. Some of us have to work long hours just to pay that credit card. Just to have that right car with the right name so that we can be somebody. This stupid plastic metal gives me meaning? And Jesus is saying, I have holes in my hands. And that's where you're getting your meaning? What's your attitude towards the Word of God? What's your attitude towards the Bible? Turn to James chapter 1. James chapter 1. Starting in verse 16. James chapter 1, starting in verse 16. Do not be deceived. Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. And I want to say, you know, we received a lot of love during our sabbatical. Even some of you young people encouraged me in my sabbatical. And I want to tell you, I love you. I love this congregation. And I am 100% committed to studying and communicating the Bible, the Word of God. With all that I have, I want to love you by communicating, feeding you from the Word of God. My beloved brethren, every good thing given and every perfect gift is from above, not ESPN, not what the world offers. Coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shifting shadow. In the exercise of his will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, so that we would be a kind of first fruit among his creatures. This you know, my brethren, my beloved brethren. But everyone who must be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. For the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. Therefore, putting aside all filthiness and all that remains of wickedness, in humility, receive the word implanted, which is able to save your souls. But prove yourself doers of the word and not merely hearers who delude themselves. For anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks into his natural face in a mirror, and once he has looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he was. But one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, and abides by it, not having become a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer, this man will be blessed in what he does. What is your attitude towards the Word of God? Is it something that, read a chapter a day, keeps the devil away, and you just read a little bit of it, check, I've done it. It's a matter of spending time and listening to the Lord and through His Word. May the Spirit inform us and guide us, and then obey the Word of God. Live by the Word of God. You see? But this deception comes and it comes and it comes in many different ways. And hypocrites are everywhere in our times. People telling us lies. Lies, lies, lies. Even about Christianity. That's why so many young people are turned off. Well, we know, we understand, we heard a great sermon. But man, mom and dad are not living according to the Word of God. Why should I? The church leaders are not living according to the Word of God. Why should I? It's all hypocrisy. We have to be very, very alert, brothers and sisters. And this is what Matthew 16 points out. So let's turn there. Because you see, the Bible is absolutely relevant when understood right. You see, it's not about just having Bible knowledge. People can have Bible knowledge, Bible knowledge, Bible knowledge, and not know God. In Matthew 16, Jesus has already proven himself to be Messiah. He has done miracle after miracle after miracle. And the nation has rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. And now he is focusing on his disciples, because he is discipling his disciples. You see? And that's where you and I come. We need to look at the word of Jesus and follow him. And it's very, very instructive. This is 12 verses that we're going to cover. And I'm telling you, we can spend a long time in these 12 verses. But my introduction was too long, so here we go. Verse 1. Matthew 16 and verse 1. The Pharisees and, look at that, the Pharisees and the Sadducees came up testing Jesus. They asked him to show them a sign from heaven. But he replied to them, when it is evening, you say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be a stormy day, for the sky is red and threatening. Do you know how to discern the appearance of the sky? And cannot discern the signs of the times? And even an adulterous generation seeks after a sign, and a sign will not be given to it except the sign of Jonah. And he left them and went away. And the disciples came to the other side of the sea, But they had forgotten or neglected to bring any bread. And Jesus said to them, "Watch out and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees." They began to discuss this among themselves, saying, "He said that because we did not bring any bread." But Jesus, aware of this, said, "You men of little faith, why do you discuss among yourselves that you have no bread? Do you not yet understand or remember the 5 loaves of the 5,000? And how many baskets full did you pick up? Or the 7 loaves of the 4,000? And how many baskets full you picked up? How is it that you do not understand that I did not speak to you concerning bread? But we bear of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees." Then they understood that he did not say to beware of the leaven of bread, but of the teaching of the Pharisees and Sadducees. And I extend it to the teachings of the world, to the teachings of the global cultural industries that are discipling you and me. Beware of the lies and hypocrisy. So here was Jesus. He had done miracle after, chapter 14, he fed 5,000. Chapter 15, he fed 4,000. Chapter 14, he walked on water. And everybody knew about it. News about Jesus spread everywhere. And there, here comes these jokers. The Pharisees and the Sadducees is very important. The Pharisees were the religious people, the people that knew the law, the Old Testament, and they knew all the rules and regulations. They added a few themselves, and religious, self-righteous religious people. And the Sadducees were more of the political, aristocratic, rich, educated people. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees did not like each other. They were against one another. The Pharisees believed in angels and resurrection, and the Sadducees were like, how idiotic. They hated each other. But here, they came together to trap Jesus. And it is a brazen, arrogant, cocky question they're asking Jesus. In the previous chapter, they had sent a lawyer to try and trap Jesus. Jesus took all his clothes and sent him away naked. And now let's get politicians. They know how to trap him. All right. And they come and they both come together, united against Jesus. "Hey, Jesus, show us a trick. Show us a sign from heaven. And then we'll know. We will declare whether you are from God or not." We approach Jesus arrogantly. The world approaches Jesus arrogantly, as if we can explain Jesus, the historical Jesus. Be quiet. There's all kinds of programs. They claim that they know all about Jesus, and it's all, oh my goodness. They don't go to the Word of God. You see. Jesus had already proven over and over, but they were hypocrites. Hypocrites. And so, Jesus, first of all, he builds them up. "Hey man, you can tell in the morning the sky is red. It's going to be a good day. In the evening, it's going to rain. And you can tell that, man. You're good. You're good at the physical things. You can tell. You're so good, and yet you do not know the Word of God. You do not know the power of God. And the world knows all about the physical being, right? I mean, all, look at the magazines. Perfect shape. Know about nutrition, know about exercise. Just do it. I mean, and they're impressive. Very impressive. But they have zero idea of the spiritual and what God is all about. You see? And so Jesus says, man, you know about all the physical. Man, you can tell the weather. But you cannot tell the work of God in your times. You do not discern the things of God. And many times, brothers and sisters, that's what we are at. And what does it say? You adulterous generation seeking after a sign. Let me have special effects. Let me have a movie that lasts. And man, I'm in my seat of my chair all the, through the movie. Look at that. Oh, did you see that? Oh, that was great. Oh, what a concert. What about God? Well, maybe Sunday. And that's where we are. He called it what it is, brothers and sisters. He called it what it is. An adulterous generation seeking after a sign. But the only sign you're going to get is the sign of judgment. The sign of Jonah. That's all you're going to get. And once you and I reject the word of God, brothers and sisters, it doesn't end well. You can become a millionaire. It's not going to end well. Did you listen to Psalm 49? Unbelievable. Go back and read it again when you have a chance. All you're going to get is a sign of Jonah. Now go back to the disciples. And on the one hand, I'm very encouraged by the disciples because I'm just as dumb as they are. I mean, it's crazy. So they go to the other side, and it says the disciples forgot to bring bread. Literally, the word means they neglected. Maybe they were presumptuous. Hey, Jesus fed 5,000, five loaves. He fed 4,000. I mean, come on. Surely he's got bologna and cheese for us. We don't have to bring. We don't have to be responsible. So they neglected to bring bread. And the likelihood is that by that time, just you have to imagine. And by the way, with narrative literature, you have to do that. You have, when you're reading narrative literature, stories like that, you're like, sheep. How do sheep smell? Donkeys, how do donkeys sound? I don't know. You have to imagine what's going on. Right here, they go to the side and they have no bread. What's going on? They're probably hungry, right? Man, nothing left in the lunchbox. The cooler's empty. I'm hungry. Hey, Jesus, we forgot to bring bread. And Jesus uses their very hunger to make a point. But they are so dense, just like me. They are so dense. So Jesus says in verse 6, he says to them, watch out and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Beware of the leaven. And what do? They go back to the physical, right? Man, I forgot the barbecue sandwich. Sorry. And I'm hungry. What are we going to say? No, he's saying that because we didn't bring bread. And by that time, the disciples had found out something. The disciples had found out that Jesus could see right through them. Jesus could see right through them. Jesus understood more about them than they understood about themselves. So when they're talking to each other in verse 7, they begin to discuss this among themselves. It's like, Jesus knows. Oh my goodness. We forgot. And he's going to nail us. He's going to nail us. That was your responsibility. No, I thought you were going to get it. And Jesus is like, hello? Verse 8, but Jesus, aware of this, said to them, O you of little faith. It's amazing what Jesus just, Jesus has this ability to, here's the problem.
What's the problem? You have no faith in me. It's about faith. It's not about the physical things. You see? And the world is discipling you and me for the physical things. Buy more. Buy more. That's where you're going to have life. You travel more. That's your happiness. That's your fulfillment. All this. Jesus says, oh, you have little faith. Why do you discuss among yourselves that you have no bread? Do you not understand? Remember the five loaves? 5,000 people, by the way, it was 5,000 men plus women and children. And usually there's at least the same amount of women and then you add children. It's probably more like 12,000 people that he fed with five loaves. Don't you remember how many baskets you picked up from five loaves? And then, or the seven loaves of the 4,000, and then it says 4,000 men plus women and children. How is it that you do not understand that I do not speak to you concerning bread? But beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Then they understood that he did not say beware of the leaven of bread, but of the teachings of the Pharisees. And the leaven is the hypocrisy. The hypocrisy. Hypocrisy, lying. Putting on a front that's fake. The real thing is back there. Right? Putting on a show. And by the way, Luke 12, verse 1, makes it, just for your reference, if you one of these days want to go there and just look at what this means. Luke 12, verse 1, under the circumstances, after so many thousands of people had been gathered together and they were stepping on one another, he began saying to his disciples, first of all, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. And how does leaven work? How does that work? You ladies especially know that can cook, right? You add a little leaven, and what happens? It spreads through the whole bread, and it makes it puff up, right? Makes it taste good too. But it spreads, right? Well, here it says, beware of the hypocrisy of the Pharisees and Sadducees. Beware of the lies. Because once you start accepting the lies, it's going to spread through your whole life. It's going to spread in your marriage. It's going to spread with your family. It's going to spread with your co-workers. It's going to spread everywhere once you start accepting the hypocrisy, the lies. And these global cultural industries are full of lies. And that's who's discipling you and me. That's why we have no time for God. God is an afterthought. God is I guess I'm supposed to spend time with God. You see, we've been discipled well, and we have bought into the leaven of the world. And so, here, the disciples had learned about Jesus, right? The disciples had been with Jesus. They had seen all the miracles. They had experienced Jesus and the power of Jesus. But they, listen to this, they needed to stay learning. They needed to be humble and say, Lord, teach me. You see, no matter how much Bible knowledge we have, we need to be under the Word of God, learning, ever learning. With humility and say, Lord, teach me. You see. The disciples, can you imagine? Jesus live in your day, all day long? 3 years? They had to learn. They had to continue to be taught. The disciples had plenty of information about Jesus. The Pharisees and the Sadducees had plenty of information about Jesus already. Point. It's not so much about intellect. It's not so much of getting more and more and more information. It's about having a heart receptive to the Word of God and a heart willing to obey. You see? A heart that's willing to obey. It's not about having all the answers to all the Christian questions about all, you know, apologetics and all these things. Those things are good, don't get me wrong. But are we living, are we applying the Word of God? Are we receiving it by faith? Oh, you of little faith, Jesus told them, right? Have you put your faith in the world? Or have you put your faith in Jesus Christ? Where are you putting your faith? It needs to be in the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, the one who paid for all of your sins. Have you? You might know the Bible. You might be in a church for low this many years. Have you ever believed that Jesus paid for all of your sins? All of your sins. You see. And if you have trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, praise be to God. Oh, listen. You know what the Bible tells us? When one sinner repents, all the angels rejoice. All of heaven rejoices. It's just absolutely awesome if you've ever trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's just glorious. You know? Luke 15, Luke 16. But then, I suspect that most of us in this audience, and those are you that are watching on Facebook, I suspect that most of us have trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, but then, we are distracted, we go with the discipleship of the world, and we give in, and we give in, and we give in, and by the time you know it, we're not living for Christ. We're living to pay bills. John 6, that was my first application, just to add a passage to that. John 6, verse 26. John 6, verse 26. Jesus answered them and said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you seek me not because you saw signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not work for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you, for on him the Father God has set his seal." Therefore, they said to him, "What shall we do so that we may work the works of God?" Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What then do you do for a sign so that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform?" "Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread out of heaven to eat." They were still focusing on the physical, right? Verse 32, Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread out of heaven, but it is my Father who has given you the true bread out of heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down out of heaven and gives life to the world." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst." And we have to make that shift because the world is discipling us on all the physical things. Make money, make money, make money, make money, so you can get stuff. And here we go. That's your meaning in life. That's your fulfilling life. That is life. Stuff! It's a lie from hell. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. But it has to be taken by faith. By faith. Have you? Have you? Maybe you need to make another shift today. God forgive me. God forgive me. I need Jesus. Then application number two. Jesus' own words. Beware of the hypocrisy of the world. The world says it knows about what really brings life. Here Jesus, beware, says we need to observe and be on guard for the examples. We as a church of Jesus Christ, are we following the culture or are we following Jesus Christ? Are we following the pleasures and fulfillments of the world or are we looking to Jesus Christ? Beware, beware, beware. They are discipling and it's an awful enemy that gets into our minds and our hearts and we're not even aware. We're not even aware of it. And by the time you know it, we're so weak as Christians. We're so afraid of the world criticizing us. Oh, you're not wearing those right types of jeans. Oh, you're not driving that right type of car. Oh, you mean you're not having a party? Oh my goodness. Are you from the Stone Age? You're not having a party for your daughter? My goodness. One last passage. Proverbs chapter 3. Proverbs chapter 3. I don't know why, but I feel like saying, are you sure you like me coming back? I'm convicted by what I'm preaching. Oh. Proverbs chapter 3. Starting in verse 1. Proverbs chapter 3, starting in verse 1. My son, you're not in my congregation, but my congregation, do not forget my teaching, but let your heart keep my commandments for length of days and years of life, and peace they will add to you. Do not let kindness and truth leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them in the tablet of your heart. So you will find favor and good repute in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him. And He will make your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. It will be healing for your body and refreshment for your bones. Honor the Lord with your wealth and from the first of all your produce. So your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. My son, do not reject the discipline of the Lord or loathe His reproof. For whom the Lord loves, He reproves, even as a father corrects his son in whom he delights. Where are you in the Lord? We all need to be humble and receive from God and say, Lord, thank you for the reproof. Thank you for showing me, Lord. I've been giving in to the wrong discipler. I need to be discipled by Jesus Christ. I need to be discipled by the Word of God. Will you? Heavenly Father, thank you for your Word. Thank you that you are so patient with us, God. Full of mercy and grace. Grace upon grace is what we have received. Oh God. Father, we pray that your Spirit would have freedom with all our hearts, Lord.
And that those who have never trusted in Jesus would be the greatest day this morning, this day, that they would stop trusting in themselves, in the world, and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior and as Lord. Be with us, Father, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.